So welcome to the continuation of module 4 Java programming for the course EC312. So we are having our fourth lecture. We'll be talking about classes, objects and methods in this lecture. So classes, as the name indicates, provides a method for packing together a group of logically related data items and functions that work on them. So data items in a class is called as fields and the functions is called as a method. So once a class type is created, then we can define variable of this type. And these variables are called as objects. So you are having a, so class is kind of where you are packing both the data and the functions. And the variable that you declare for a class is called as an object. So syntax for a class is you have the keyword class space class name, and then there is an optional field which says extends super class name. So this comes if you are inheriting this class from a different class. Inside the class, then you can have a field declaration and the method declaration. So whatever is there in the square bracket is optional. So you can either have only field declaration, you can have either only method declaration, you can have both of them together, or you can have none of them. So this is basically class. Now let's look into each of these members inside the class. First is called as a field. So data is encapsulated in a class by placing data fields inside the body of class definition. So you have a class inside which you are declaring some data. You are declaring a variable to hold some data. So these variables are called as instance variable, as they are created only when the object of the class is instantiated. So when you create an object, then only these variables are created in the memory. So when you declare a class without creating an object, it doesn't allocate a memory in the RAM. But when you declare an object of this class, then the required amount of memory will be allocated. So this is an example where you have two field definitions, two member variables. One is called as length, one is called as width. Both are of type integer. So int means like the length will get allocated 32-bit memory. Width will also get allocated 32-bit memory. And these two will be allocated only when you declare the object. So methods are like functions, or they're exactly functions, but it is defined inside the body of the class. And methods are used to manipulate the data inside the class. So if you continue with the previous example of rectangle, so you already have the member variables or fields, which is length and width. Then you have defined a function inside the class, that is void get data index comma int y. So and inside the function, you are just copying the value of the parameters to each of the member data members, that is x is copied to length, y is copied to width, and this function is called as a method. So the method name is getData. The method is not returning any kind of data, because of which it is void. The method is accepting two input parameters, x and y, and both are of type data type integer. So here's an example for you. So there is a class being defined here, and there are some method, there is a method and a field or a data member being declared. So you want to find what is the name of the class, what are the fields and methods inside the following class, what is the return type, method name, and input parameters of the method. So if you look at this, you need to find out what are all these class, methods, return type, method name, and input parameters. And let's move forward. So let's say you are going to create an object. So an object in Java is essentially a block of memory that contains space to store all the instance variables. So when you create an object, whatever is declared inside the class will be allocated a memory, or you can say a block of memory in which they can be stored. So creating an object is also referred to as instantiating an object. So when you say create an object, it is equivalent to saying instantiating. And objects in Java are created using new operator. The new operator creates an object of class and returns a reference to that object. So if you take this example, rectangle rect1. So this doesn't create an object. It only declare a variable rect1, and it will not be allocated a memory. Just says that you are declaring a variable rect1. Now, so when is the object created? So when you assign this variable rect1 using new rectangle, so when you say new, it means you are going to create a new memory location of type rectangle, and the reference of that memory location is passed to the rect1 variable. So this is where the actual object is being created. So in the previous example, in the previous slide, we have seen that you have done this instantiation or creating an object in two steps. Basically, you can do it in a single step, where you say rectangle rect1 is equal to new rectangle. So both are same. So this will both are same, except that you are creating the object in two steps here, while you are creating object in a single step here. So you can create any number of objects for the same class. So in this example, if you see rect1, you are creating a new object, rect2, you are creating another object, and these two objects are totally different. So these are two different memory locations, and the variables or the methods and data members of both of them are different. Although they have the same name, they allocate different memory locations, because of which when you access these members, they will be different. So each object has its own copy of instance variable of its class. That is, any changes to the variables of one object have no effect on variables of other. So if you look at this block diagram, so there is a memory location of rectangle. It has its variables, methods, etc. here. This rect1 object is pointing to that memory location. There's a totally different memory location, but of the same type rectangle. Again, it has variables and methods inside this one. Rect2 is pointing to this memory location. So these two memory locations are totally different. So whenever you access the variables and methods using rect1, that is totally different from rect2. But let's say you want to have both these objects pointing to same memory location. Still, you can do that. So you can declare the first object as R1, and it is created a new memory location, or it is instantiated as new rectangle one. You create a different variable R2, and you just say R2 equal to R1, which means the R1 and R2 are pointing to the same memory location rectangle. So whatever variables or methods in R1 is equivalent to the variables and methods in R2. And if you change anything using R1, it will get reflected in R2. Now let's say how we can access the class members. So we have the class member as, we have variables and methods as class members. So we need to access each of them outside the class. How will you access it? The syntax is, you create an object of the class, you say object name dot variable name, and you assign a value. So if it is a variable, you can assign the value using dot operator. Object name dot method name, and if you have parameter in that method, you just pass the parameters, it will be passed. So example for accessing the variables is like this. So in the previous example, we have seen rect1 is an object being created. Length and width are two members of the class, which are variables. So you can say rect1.length equal to 15 and rect1.width equal to 10. So basically, you are assigning a value 10 to width, 15 to length. Now rect2 is a different object. So rect2.length equal to 20, rect2.width equal to 12 will assign a value 12 to width and 20 to length. So you should note that rect1 and rect2 are two different objects, which means the length and width of each of these objects are different, and they will get different value get assigned. So we look at an elaborate example. So this is a very basically an example where you have the class rectangle. You have two variables are declared, length and width, member variables. You have methods get data and rectangle area. So rect area will calculate the area of the rectangle and return the area. You have declared in a different class the void main function, and you are doing many things inside the main function. So let's go step by step. So initially you have declared the variables length and width, You have declared the methods inside the class rectangle. One is getData with input parameters x and y of type int. You have rectArea being declared, which is a method. It doesn't have an input parameter. It is returning an integer data type. And you have declared a second class called as rectArea, which contains the main function. And inside the main function, you are creating two objects of the class rectangle. One is rect1 and other is rect2. Now, the length and width are directly accessed in this step using the object rect1. So rect1.length is 15 and rect1.width is 10. So that the member variables are directly accessed using the object rect1. Then you are directly accessing these variables of rect1 length and rect1 width to calculate the area, which is just the multiplication of this. Instead, let's say in the case of the object rect2, I'm not accessing length and width directly, but instead I am using this method getData to initialize the variable. So when I say getData of 20,12, I am passing the value 20 to x, 12 to y. Inside, I am copying the value of x to length and y to width. So x, so length now will be 20, width now will be 12. And then I am using the next method, rectArea, calling that function, will multiply the current length and width and return me the area. So the area 2 now will have the value of 20 into 12, which is 240. And this is a print statement. So area 1 and area 2, they are totally different because one is using rect1 object and area 2 is using rect2 objects. So area 1, which will be printed as 150, and area 2 will be printed as 240. So a class can also have something called as a constructor. So constructor is a special type of method which is used to initialize the object. If you had looked at the previous example, we had length and width as variables. So when you create an object, you need to know what should be the value of length and width. So either you can do it yourself by declaring a method, or while you create the object, you can initialize those variables. So that initialization can be done using a constructor. So every time an object is created using new keyword, at least one constructor is called. So if the programmer hasn't defined a constructor, then the compiler will provide you a constructor called as default constructor. And compiler will initialize those variables for you if the programmer hasn't written a constructor. But there are some rules for creating constructor. First and foremost, the constructor name must be same as its class name. And constructor must not have no explicit return type. So the name of the constructor, which is a method, which is a function, should be same as of class name, and the constructor should not return any values. A Java constructor cannot be abstract, static, final, or synchronized. So these are different keywords in Java that we will look as we go. So default constructor. So these are different types of constructor. First is default constructor. If you look at this inside the class, you can see that a constructor should have the same name of that of the class. So there is no such constructor being defined inside this class. There's only one method, which is display. So when you create this object, ideally it should go to the constructor and execute the constructor, but there is no constructor defined, because of which the compiler will provide you a constructor implicitly and initialize the variable id and name. So constructor is basically for initializing the variables inside the class. So since the programmer is not doing that, the compiler will initialize it. So compiler by default will initialize the value id to 0 and name to null. Now there is a parameterized constructor. A constructor which has a specific number of parameters is called as a parameterized constructor. This a programmer should explicitly define in the class. The parameterized constructor is to provide different values to distinct objects. However, it can provide the same value also. Let's take an example. So if you see this method student4, it has the name same as that of the class, and it is a method. It has input parameters I, which is an integer, n, which is a string. This is a constructor, and inside the constructor value of I is copied to the member variable ID, and value of N is copied to the member variable name, which is basically you have initialized the member variables. Now, when is this initialization happens? When you execute this statement, when you say new student for of 111 comma current, the value 111 will be passed to I and current will be passed to N, which initializes ID and name. So the object S1 will have a variable ID with value 111 and variable name with string current. Now, when you're creating the object S2, you are again calling the constructor because you are passing this 222 I arg to N. So for S2 object, the value of the variable ID is 222 and the value of the name is arg. So that you have initialized. Now when you display it separately using two different different objects, S1.display will give you ID as 111, name as current. S2.display will give you ID as 222 and name as arg. Next, we go to method overloading. So we have seen what a method is. Method is basically a function which is defined inside the class. So overloading means you can define functions or define methods of the same name, but with different number of input parameters or type of input parameters. So method overloading is used when objects are required to perform similar tasks, but using different input parameters. So depending on the input parameters, you can define different methods but with the same name. So when you call a method in an object, Java matches the method name first, then number and type of parameters to decide which one of the definitions to execute. Method overloading is a form of polymorphism. Method overloading increases readability of the program. So we'll see an example to understand it better. So there are two types of method overloading. First one is by changing the number of arguments. So if you see here, there's a class called as adder, and I have defined two methods, but with the same name, add. That's a static method. We'll see what static method is. But the methods have two different number of arguments. So first method add has a and b, which is two arguments. Second method has a, b, and c of type int, but with three input arguments. So these two are called as method overloading because you have the same method name but different number of arguments. Forget about static because static doesn't cause anything in the method overloading. So static means that you can access these functions without an object, that's all. Now when I say adder.add 11, 11, so when I call 11, 11, that is with two arguments, the compiler knows that it should call this function, which is a plus b. Similarly, when I call add 11, 11, 11, the compiler know that it should call the function with three input arguments, which is a comma b comma c. So in each of these two cases, compiler know, depending on the number of arguments, which of the overloaded functions to call, and it will call that functions. The functionality is same, but the number of arguments are different. The next type of method overloading is called as by the data type change. So again, the same example, but the input arguments for both add overloaded add methods are same. Number of input arguments are same. They differ in the type of data. So even if one of the arguments data type is different, the compiler will treat it as overloaded methods. So when I call add function with integer values 11, 11, the first add method will be called because it takes input arguments of type int. And when I call add with decimal point numbers or floating numbers, the compiler knows that it needs to call the add method which accepts floating or a double point numbers, and so this method will be called. And the last one is static member. So we have seen static methods in our previous example. So let's see what the static is. So whenever an object of class is created, you know that there are separate memory locations being created for variables and method. That is good. But what if we don't want that? What if we say that whenever a new object is created, I should not use a new memory location? So there comes the static. When a variable or method is declared static, it is common to all objects. In other words, these variables and methods can be accessed using the class name and not by using an object. So any static member can be accessed directly by class name. You don't want to create an object for that static member, whether it is a static data member or static method. You can directly use the class name, and you can use dot, and you can access the member. Static members belong to the class as a whole rather than the objects. So let's see an example. You see that this two methods. So we have declared a class math operation. It has two methods, mul and divide, both are static. And there is a class math application which we have defined the main function. And main function is called this method mul and divide. So the static method mul and divide has input arguments x and y, and they do the required function and return the value. When I want to call the multiplication functions, which is mul, you see that I haven't declared an object for math operation. Instead, I directly use the class name, which is math operation dot mul, and I pass the arguments which will eventually call this static function. So here, if you look at this, I haven't defined an object, like I have been accessing this mul function without defining an object. I can directly use the class name. Similarly, for divide is a static function. I'm again using directly the class name math operation dot divide. I am passing the value a comma 2.0. So again, this doesn't need a static function. This uses a static function. It doesn't need an object. So here are some questions on our lecture. You can go through the questions. It will help you in understanding lecture. And there is a programming exercise, where the simple programming exercise where you can create a bank account, everything. And this is something where you can try it out. So already the code is given, but you need to modify this code to achieve a desired result. And there is one bug in this code. You can try to solve the bug. Okay. Thank you. Hi, welcome to module 4 Java programming for the course EC312 object oriented programming. So we are going to look at lecture 5, and the topic is inheritance. So what do you mean by inheritance? Inheritance in Java is a mechanism in which one object acquires all the properties and behaviors of a parent object. So you can create classes which is derived from a parent class. The derived class is called as child class. And when you create an object of the child class, you can see that some of the properties or all the properties of the parent class can be acquired. So the main idea behind creating this inheritance is that you can always reuse the things that is there in the parent class. You can reuse the methods or fields of the parent class. Also, you can add new methods and fields in your child class. So let's look at some of the terms that is being used in inheritance. The class that we have already seen is a group of objects which have common properties. So it will have variables or fields and methods. A subclass or a child class is a class which inherits some other class. So it is also called as derived class, extended class, or child class. Now, superclass or parent class is the class from where a subclass inherits the features. So this class is the one which gets inherited. And it's also called as base class or a parent class. Now, reusability, as the word means, that you can reuse some or all the features of the parent class in the child class. The syntax of defining a subclass is, you have this class name, you have the class keyword, space the class name, and there's a special keyword called as extends, and then the superclass name. So extends means you are inheriting subclass from the superclass, and then as the class have, you will have variable declaration and method declaration inside the class. And the subclass will have many variables and methods as its own. So let's look at one example. So this is an example of two classes. One is, first class name is employee, second class name is programmer. Now employee class has defined one variable or one field inside it, which is called a salary. It is a float variable. The programmer has defined a variable called as bonus, which is of int type, and there is a static main function inside this. Now if you look at this programmer class, you can see that the programmer class extends employee. So extends is the keyword, which means that the programmer class is inherited from employee. So the employee is called as the superclass and programmer is called as the subclass. So inside programmer, we have defined one field or variable, member variable, which is bonus, and there is a static function, which is the main function. Here you are creating an object of the programmer. So programmer p equal new programmer creates an object of the class programmer. Now if you look at this print statement, basically you are printing the salary, but the salary is actually a member of employee. It is not a member of the inherited class programmer. But since the programmer is inherited from employee and the salary is a default access specifier, you can always access salary using the object of the derived class or the subclass. So subclass object, that is p dot salary, will print you 40,000. And bonus is actually a member variable of programmer class. You can directly access using the object of the programmer or the subclass, and p dot bonus will print you 10,000. So if you look at the block diagram of this representation, basically you have this employee class, which is called a superclass. It is deriving, the programmer class inherits from employee class. So there is an arrow down. So this type of inheritance is called a single inheritance, where there is only one subclass inherited from the superclass. So let's look at the types of inheritance. So there are, Java supports mainly three types of inheritance: single inheritance, multi-level inheritance, and hierarchical inheritance. Java also supports multiple and hybrid, but that is using interfaces. So we will be seeing interfaces at a data stage. As I explained earlier, the employee and programmer. So this is a single level inheritance, where the employee and where the programmer inherits the properties of the employee class. So let's look at multi-level inheritance. So in multi-level inheritance, there's a chain of inheritance. Chain in the sense like you inherit from one class and that in class inherits from another. So for example, animal is inherited to dog, dog is inherited to baby dog. So if you look at class animal, you have a function called as eat or method eat. The class dog is inherited from class animal. There is a function for dog or method for dog, which is bark. Class baby dog is inherited from dog, and there is a method called beep. Now if you create an object of the subclass, which is the last subclass, which is baby dog, you can access all the functionalities of the superclasses. So beep is a functionality of subclass. So d, which is an object of the lowermost subclass, I can directly do d dot beep, which will access this. Now I can do d dot bark, because baby dog is inherited from dog class, so I can access the methods of the dog class. And d dot eat, eat is actually not a method of baby dog class or dog class, it's actually a method of animal class. But since baby dog is inherited from dog, which is inherited from animal, you can access d dot eat using the object of the subclass. Hierarchical inheritance is where from a single superclass you have inherited multiple subclasses. So animal is the superclass. Now dog inherits from animal, it has a method bark. Cat also inherits from animal, it has a method meow. And then when you create, you can create an object of class subclass, and then I can say c.meow, which is the method in the subclass, and I can also say c.eat, which is a method in the superclass. But you cannot say c.bark because there is no relation between the class dog and class cat, because the inheritance is only from animal. So you cannot say c.bark, which will give you error. So we are going to look at something called as method overriding. So method overriding occurs mainly when your subclass and the parent class, which is a superclass, have the same method declared. So same method in the sense it has the same name, it has the same return type, it has the same number of parameters, and all the parameters are exactly same with the same data type. So that you have declared methods, two methods defining subclass and superclass with same name, same number of parameters, same type of parameter. Then if you call the method from using an object, then the method of the subclass is invoked and executed instead of that one in the superclass. So let's look at an example or before that. So usage of Java method overriding is mainly in some scenarios in which, for example, the superclass has declared a method. Now you want to add something more to that same method. So if you want to add more something to that same method, you can do method overriding. And method overriding is something called as is used for runtime polymorphism. But there are some rules for method overriding. First and foremost, must have the same name as that in the parent class. They have the same parameter as that in the parent class. And there should be an inheritance relation between the classes, that the superclass should be derived from the subclass. So that if just two classes are entirely different, you cannot do method overriding. You can do method overriding only if there is an inheritance relationship. So if you look at the example, so vehicle is the superclass, bike is a subclass. Bike extends vehicle means you have derived bike to from vehicle. But if you look at a method, you have both defined a method void run in superclass and subclass, and then you are creating an object of the subclass, which is obj. Now when I call obj.run, now since bike2 and vehicle has run, it is always possible to access the method in the superclass using the object in the subclass. That is always possible. But since both of them have the same method, only the method in the subclass will get executed, and the method in the superclass will not get executed. So this is called as method overriding. So we'll see how we can access the method in superclass also, but currently this is called as method overriding. There are some limitations in method overriding. So a final or a static or a private methods cannot be overridden. So we'll see what a final method is. And the overriding method must have same return type. So if the methods are of different return types, the overriding will not work. So now let's look at something called a super keyword. So this is where that overriding that you can access a function of superclass works. So if same variable or method is declared in both superclass and subclass, now how to invoke both of them? Now I want to access the variable in superclass and I also want to access the variable in subclass. Now both have the same name, it can be a variable or a method. Now there the super keyword will come into picture. So super keyword in Java is a reference variable which is used to refer immediate parent class object. So the parent class just above the subclass or superclass just above the subclass, you can refer using the super keyword. So whenever you create the instance of subclass, an instance of parent class is created implicitly, which is referred by superclass super reference variable. Now usage of super keyword. There are mainly three uses. Now super can be used to refer immediate parent class instance variable. It can be used to invoke immediate parent class method, or it can be used to invoke immediate parent class constructor. So let's say an example to understand it better. So super to refer immediate parent class instance variable. So if you look at the class animal and class dog, the dog is inherited from animal and both have the same variable color. So animal is a super class, dog is a subclass, and there is independent class called a test super one, which has the main function, and it doesn't have anything to do with animal class or dog class. It just creates an object of the dog class and print the color. The animal class has the variable color. It has initialized with value white. It's a string data type. The dog class has a variable color. It is also a string data type, but with initialized with black. Now, here I am creating the object for dog. Now I want to access, since both the variables or both the variables are of same name, I can access d.color, which will directly access the animal, dog class variable, but I want to access the animal class variable also. So here what we do is you use super keyword. So when you say super.color, it is referring to the immediate superclass of the subclass. So this dog has an immediate superclass animal. So in that animal superclass, if there's a color defined, that is being accessed here, super.color. If you just say color, it is the color variable in the current class, which is inside the dog class. So this will print black, and super.color will print white. Superclass can be also used to invoke parent class method. So here, if you look, the same class, animal and dog, both classes has defined same method, which is eat. So eat is defined in both the classes. Now, if I want to access eat from the base class or the subclass, which is in the superclass, I need to do something. Like when I do just call eat, then it will call the eat in the subclass. So what I do, I'll do super dot eat. So super dot eat will call the eat method, which is just above, just immediate to the current subclass. So just immediate superclass of current subclass is animal. Super dot eat will call the eat functionality of the animal superclass. So this is to invoke parent class method. So this super keyword is mostly used when you have methods or variables of same name and same type in both derived or both superclass and subclass. Now it can be also used to invoke parent class constructor. So this is an example. So here you are creating a object of dog. So when you create an object of any class, the construct of that class is invoked. So here, when you create dog d is equal to new dog, this constructor, which is dog constructor, is invoked. It will not invoke the constructor of superclass. So if you want to invoke the constructor of superclass, then inside the constructor of the subclass, you need to call, just call super, no parameters. It will call the constructor of the superclass. So super keyword is always used to access the variables, methods, and constructor of the superclass from the subclass. There is a keyword called as final. Now final keyword in Java is to restrict the user. It can be used in a context of variable, method, or class. So as the name indicates, now the final keyword will not allow some of the properties to change. Let's look at some of them. So let's say the variable is final. So if you look at this example, I have a class called as bike. I have defined a final int speed limit equal to 90. I have defined a variable called as speed limit, which is of integer type, and have initialized the value to 90. But this is a final variable. And inside void run method, I am changing that variable. So speed limit is changed to 400. This will give you a compilation error, because if the keyword final exists for a variable and variable is initialized, you cannot change the value of this variable at any point of time. So when you say object.run, you are actually accessing this run method and you are changing the variable. This is not possible, because you have defined speed limit as final, which is basically like a constant. Like you can change the value of a constant. So basically you are trying to do 90 is equal to 400, which is not possible. Now let's see what happens when you are defining a method as final. See, here in bike, class bike, I have a method called as run, which is final. Class Honda is inherited from bike, and I also have the same method, which is run. I have created an object Honda, and I am calling the method run, which basically calls the method here in the subclass. But if you have declared a method in superclass as final, you cannot override that method. That means you cannot define the same method in the subclass. So basically this will give you a compilation error. This is not possible, because if there was no final method, final keyword here, then this run will have been overridden, and it will print running safely with 100 km per hour. But since the final keyword is there with the method in the superclass, it will directly give a compilation error saying that this is a final method in superclass, you cannot override the method in the subclass. Now let's look at the access modifiers in Java. So as long as we have seen the public access specifier many times along with the main function. There are other access specifiers or modifiers also. First is private, and private is the most private one, means it cannot be any variable or any method declared as private cannot be accessed outside the class. This is similar to that of C++. There is a default access specifier. So if you look at any example previously, we haven't specified any access specifier for method or variable. So this is a default access specifier, that by default, what is access specifier? So if an access specifier is default, it can be accessed only within the package. It cannot be accessed outside the package. There is protected, and protected access specifier, you can modify within the package and outside the package. But if you are having outside the package, then there should be a child class for that, from that package. So if there is no child class, it cannot be accessed. Public, you can access from anywhere, within package, outside class, where. So this is a small chart on visibility chart, basically from where all you can access each of the variables or methods defined with public, protected, default and private. So public, you can see, you can access from class, package, subclass of the same package, subclass of different package, outside class, etc. Protected, outside class, you cannot access, whether it is subclass or not. Default, you cannot access from outside the package, mainly outside the class also. Private, you can access only from inside the class. You cannot access from outside the class, inside the package, in the same package, subclass, or in different package, subclass, outside class, you cannot access. So these are some questions that you can try it out. This might help you in learning the lecture easily. Thank you.